This is Caden Prescorn.
This is JJP Gies.
Hey everybody, this is Jackson Dart, Ole Miss quarterback. You're listening to the Red and Blue Crew with Dave and Brad.
Welcome to the Red and Blue Crew podcast, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. Are you ready? From the Inside the Rebels studios, let's get ready to rumble. Now here are your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan.
Hello, everyone. Welcome in. Brad Logan, David Johnson here on the Red and Blue Crew podcast. Another day, and we're coming to you twice this week because we've got some information we wanted to bring along with you, an exclusive interview with Keith Carter that David had. And there's been some stories that have dropped because of that interview. And I think the number one question, David, is his thoughts on Mike Bianco, what he thinks is going to happen with baseball at the end of the year, but so many other things to get to with what you and Keith talked about.
Yeah. Starting off with Mike Bianco, Keith didn't tell me anything I wasn't expecting to hear from him, to be quite honest. We'll sit down at the season's end and we'll evaluate everything. I left the interview thinking that Keith Carter terminating Mike Bianco is the furthest thing from Keith Carter's mind. And I know that a lot of fans, a lot of our readers were digging at that question, wanted that question asked. And I think the way I phrased it is something, let's talk about Mike Bianco's future. And Keith gave the diplomatic answer you would expect him to give, but he gave an answer. He's on the record. So, some people think I should have held a gun to his head and asked him more pointed questions, I suppose. I think I read a message to that effect on Wednesday, but I'm not going to do that. And it would have accomplished nothing. And I think I told the guy that, he ought to be working for CBS News. And, was he looking for a job? But, Keith gave a fair and honest answer. I left that interview, again, thinking anybody who wants Mike Bianco terminated is sorely disappointed. I'm not on either side of that fence. I don't have to be. I don't cover baseball. But, that's what he said. And I also asked him, in fairness, about Jamie Traxel and the Ole Miss softball program. And his response left me leaving the conversation thinking that Jamie certainly has at least one more season left to play inside of the new stadium. And in fairness, he pointed out that, the team's been practicing at M-Trade Park, that, they're playing their games in the middle of a construction site. I mean, the field's in great condition, but everything else, you see. He thinks there's a little something to that with the team maybe not playing up to the best of its abilities this year. And I left that conversation again, thinking in no shape, form, or fashion is he, he's not on red alert about the leadership of the softball program. Now, I've been covering softball since 2014, and prior to that, I actually did radio play-by-play for softball for a couple of years. I don't like the direction the program is heading, and I'll tell you, I disagree with Carter on that. I like Jamie Traxel, but if you just look at the record and where we're at now versus where we were even when she took the program over. You know, it's time to win, or I think it's time to make a move, one or the other. And in fairness to Jamie, she took the job in the middle of the pandemic and in the crappiest stadium in the SEC. I get that. But her predecessor was able to win an SEC championship playing in that same stadium. And I've always been one to tell you, stadiums, facilities do not win games. Yes, they can help a little bit in recruiting, but they do not win games. I mean, Ole Miss has fired two men's basketball coaches since the Pavilion opened its doors. So, you know, I'll leave that where it is.
The men's and women's tennis programs also are probably going to be evaluated at the end of the year, just like you pointed out in regards to sports, both Olympic and non-Olympic sports on campus. Everything is evaluated at the end of the year. And I thought the answers were exactly what we thought we would get from Keith. But just having to ask those questions means there is cause for concern for those programs. And
I'll break some news here. I haven't written the story yet. Keith did tell me both men's and women's head tennis coaches will be back. And we didn't talk much about tennis, but they will both be back for next year. We talked about the struggles the tennis program is having, a once proud tennis program. But he did volunteer and tell me both tennis coaches will be back.
And you're right. You look at the history of that program, meaning the men's and women's programs, on campus at Ole Miss, and there's some very rich and storied history with that program. And obviously, as everyone knows that follows tennis at Ole Miss, it is definitely going through some struggles right now. So some issues, obviously, sitting on Keith Carter's desk. One thing, David, is the influx of finances. Unfortunately for Keith and the university, a lot of that goes towards NIL. How do you determine what goes towards NIL versus champions now? How do you determine what to do with the different monies that are coming in? And I thought one story that you can read right now on reps247.com, that's inside the Rebels, an affiliate of 24/7 Sports. David pretty much asked him, what's next for Vaught-Hemingway Stadium? What's next with the Champions Now initiative? And I thought it was a pretty good piece.
Yeah. Outside of a little paint and some aesthetics, nothing. That's what he told me. Everything with the proposed renovations to Vaught-Hemingway Stadium that they announced at the Sugar Bowl a couple of years ago is still on the shelf. And, you know, and will be for the next several years, I think is what he told me. And, the bathrooms will get a little paint and there'll be a little paint, you know, where there needs to be, but, not going to be any big renovations. And again, facilities don't win games. They do not win games. And Ole Miss football is winning right now. So, I'm fine with that. Now, I'm also a guy that pulls into the parking garage, walks 50 feet to the elevator, shoots straight up to the press box, and sits there and watches the game in AC every Saturday. So, I understand some of the fans' concerns with restrooms and things of that nature, but there's not going to be anything major done to Vaught-Hemingway Stadium. Certainly not like what the rendering suggested a few years back.
And that's just allocation of funds and understanding the changing climate of everything revolving around college football. And without going too far off the deep end, there's been some reports, some different, people in the college football community talking about a 60-team mega conference Would Ole Miss be including in that right now? I think without question they would. And if it gets to that, then you start talking about the NCAA have already talked about revenue sharing. It's almost like we're on the fast lane to a super conference, mega payment for players, and it is NFL light is what it looks like. It's absolutely barreling towards right now.
No, it's coming. Yeah, they're, I don't think anybody can say that revenue sharing is not coming. Look, I mean, it's the natural progression, right? These players realized what they were worth. Now they're getting paid what they're worth. But they also realize these colleges are still making millions off of us. And here's why. Because ESPN and ABC and the likes are paying big time money to put us on television. And, you know, to me, revenue sharing is simply the next step. It's going to happen. And, you know, I just hope we don't end up pricing ourselves out of what was an absolute fantastic product. And I was always for the players getting their fair share. But, you know, Ole Miss sidelined the Champions Now program in part because of NIL.
Is it fair to say in large part?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is because, yeah, you know, credit to Keith Carter, credit to Dr. Boyce, that they were smart enough to realize the paradigm had shifted in college athletics, that if you want to win, you're not going to do that with a shiny stadium. You're going to do that by paying for the best possible players. And, you know, Ole Miss is ahead of the curve on that. There are some schools, even within the SEC, that are still trying to find their way, and Ole Miss is trailblazing. So, you know, kudos to Walker Jones, to Keith Carter, to Dr. Glenn Boyce. You know, great leadership, and, you know, they're turning an end to a great time to be an Ole Miss Rebel.
I want to take a sidebar just for a moment. Did you see who's going to speak at Delta State in a couple of weeks?
No, I haven't.
Archie Manning. Guess who's moderating?
Oh, boy.
Former Delta State SID, resident of Calhoun City, Mississippi, and former SID at Ole Miss, Langston Rogers.
Okay.
I thought it was really neat. I got a text from a good friend. They said Archie's coming to the Delta. They're going to do it in Walter Sillars. Talk about a place that's in need of a renovation. My goodness.
Yeah, the back wall was falling down last time I was in.
But anyway, I just look back at something, and we were talking. I actually was looking at the article that you wrote, and the lead picture for that article was Keith and Archie. And I thought about Archie going to Delta State and kind of rekindling. Now, for people listening, they know this, but maybe some friends of theirs may not. But, of course, Archie grew up in Drew, Mississippi, which is right down the road from Cleveland. So coming back, and I think it's going to be a fundraising event for Delta State, and you and I both know they need it. So it's a lot of good things happening. And one of those, definitely wanted to bring a little attention to that because Archie, you know, doesn't do a lot of speaking anymore. I thought it was really cool to see. And Langston's probably the one person that can get Archie out to do some speaking.
Yeah, you know, and I'll interject a little of my history here. You know, first of all, nobody loves Delta State as much as Langston Rogers.
Right.
And Langston was the SID at Delta State for many years. And, you know, what was there, he and Stan Sandroni, the great late Stan Sandroni, were both there for the Lady Statesmen's, you know, major college national championship run in the mid-1970s. Lucy Harris, Margaret Wade, and that crew. Langston was my Little League baseball coach in Cleveland, Mississippi, back in the late 1970s, early 1980s. He and I chatted about that not very long ago, as a matter of fact. And, you know, I wasn't much of a baseball player at the time. Ended up being a pretty decent pitcher later on. But that year they were trying to play me at catcher, and I didn't have the arm strength to make it down to second base. I was bouncing a lot. But Langston would be great. I mean, to me, in my Delta State background, it's almost as big of a deal to have Langston Rogers back as it is the great Archie Manning. But the one thing I'll say about Archie is he never forgot where he came from, and he loves where he came from, and it shows in everything he's doing, such as lending itself to this fundraising event at Delta State, which, as you mentioned, desperately needs it.
Yeah, and you and I talked with Langston, and I'd love for Langston to be in the I don't know if Delta State has a Hall of Fame. If they do, he needs to be in it. And you and I both think a whole lot of Lloyd Clark. I don't know if Lloyd's in the Women's Basketball Hall of Fame, but he deserves to be in that as well. It's just really cool to see people getting recognized. And I'm like you, I hope Langston gets recognized as much as Archie does at the event at Delta State. And I know that Coach Kennison, who's athletic director there at Delta State, he'll make sure that Langston is taken care of. Anyway, a cool event, and you and I always kind of talk a little bit about the Statesman whenever we record needed, because we love that place.
And you're right, I do love it. The guy that told me, hey, I was the first person to ever see this Manning kid from Drew and go, he's going to be a ball player. Do you know who that person was that told me that?
I do not.
Boo Ferris. Boo Ferris caught Archie Manning playing a Little League game at Fireman's Park in Cleveland. Archie was probably 10, 11 years old. And Boo was like, man, my radar went up. I could tell that redheaded kid from Drew was, oh, golly, he was going to be a good one. And, man, he was right.
And Coach Ferris would know. He's won a couple of games, that's for sure. The whole conversation about Archie and Ole Miss and then the picture I saw just goes back to kind of reeling this thing back in, is just a guy from Arkansas that likes to turkey hunt, that happens to be able to shoot a basketball, is going to go down in history as one of the best athletic directors Ole Miss has ever had. I don't think I'm crazy for saying that.
No, you're not. You're not. Keith has done a fantastic job. I don't see how anybody could criticize, what Keith has done. He inherits the athletic program, again, right smack dab in the middle of the pandemic. And, he guided us through that. Football has reached elite status. We're on the path in both men's and women's basketball, I think, to follow a similar trajectory as football has. And you can't do anything but trust Keith's decisions when it comes to baseball and softball and men's and women's tennis. You don't have those worries with the golf program. As the men yesterday earned an NCAA berth as a number 2 seed, they'll be going out to Stanford. Excited to see how that goes. Highest NCAA seed in the history of men's golf at Ole Miss. So, and then even take what Connie Smith Price is doing with the track program. I mean, we've got future Olympians that wear Rebel Red and Blue right now. More than one, I promise you. And not just females, but males that will be on the Olympic team. I think, again, it's a great time to be an Ole Miss Rebel.
Looking at the 25 recruiting class, David, we talked about it pretty in-depth. If you look at the podcast right below this one on however you're listening to today's show, you'll get a complete breakdown of the 25 class. Anybody special that you're kind of looking at a possible commitment coming down the road? I know Coach McDonald and Coach Smith kind of hinted at a possible commitment over the next couple of days. Just curious who you think might be next on that possibly trigger of committing to Ole Miss.
Yeah, it could be one of a number of guys, to be honest with you. You know, they're lining up to take their officials here now. And, you know, LaDarian Clardy is coming, as well as Major Preston. Braden Trimble's coming. All of these big-time kids are coming. You know, but I don't know necessarily who's going to be the next guy to pull the trigger. But I'll just jump right into this. You know, there's a media narrative out there that's been going on for a long time that five-star wide receiver Caleb Cunningham is going to go to Mississippi State. I bucked the trend and I crystal balled into Ole Miss. He might not go to Ole Miss. He might go to LSU. But anybody who is drinking somebody else's Kool-Aid about he's going to Mississippi State, period, is wrong. Absolutely wrong. He told me himself, and we've talked about this, that it means something to him to play at a program that can put wide receivers in the NFL, as it should. He's got all the intangibles to get there one day. And I'm paraphrasing, but his comment to me after that was, I can't tell you the last time Mississippi State did that. Period. So, you know, there were a couple of guys who jumped out there that crystal balled into Mississippi State. And all you heard about for the longest was Caleb Cunningham's coming to Mississippi State. Well, he hasn't come yet. He hasn't come yet. And talking to somebody earlier this week, they told me that Ole Miss and LSU are very much in the conversation. So we'll see what happens. Now, Caleb also told me, I'm going to sit back and I'm going to see what Mississippi State does this fall. Well, Brad, I think Jeff Lebby can win games. And I think State can go 6-6 this year and get to a bowl game, maybe even 7-5. But Lebby does not have the personnel in place yet to do the things that Lane Kiffin can do at Ole Miss. And if Caleb Cunningham is sitting back going, impress me, I think he's going to be more impressed with what the crew in Oxford does versus what the crew in Starkville does. I'll let you talk.
I'm fascinated with his recruitment. I'm fascinated to see what happens. I do know for a fact that a number of SEC programs should be talked about when you talk about this young man. A team that you didn't say that I know is very much involved in Auburn. His recruitment is Auburn. Yeah. Is Auburn. And I think with Coach Nix recruiting so hard for the state of Mississippi, even before he went to Auburn, that entire staff was very much aware of how well just how good Cunningham is. And I'm going to temper maybe a little bit of what you're saying is I do think Mississippi State is very much in position to do its best to land Caleb Cunningham. I don't think it's a slam dunk. I agree with you. But I know. He's just right down the road. He goes to Starkville a lot. He has a great relationship. But I think at the end of the day, when he's sitting down, and I think there's some comments he made to you that lend me to believe that he's much more open than people believe. And I agree with you on that. I think LSU's coming into play a little bit. And then I think as the season starts, the high school season for Cunningham and the visits start to happen over the summer, I just think his recruiting is going to get even more convoluted. I think this thing's going down to signing day. I don't think it really necessarily matters if he commits or not. The night before signing day is setting up to be wild because every year there's one or two players in the state that just have this wild recruitment, and he's definitely one of them. I think Mississippi is going to have a great class in 25. I think Ole Miss and Lane Kiffin have targeted the positions and the players that they would like, and I think it's going to go down to the wire. And so far, I think they've done a superb job recruiting the state of Mississippi. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
You're talking about Ole Miss, right?
Yeah, Ole Miss. Yeah, I think Ole Miss has done a superb job targeting and recruiting to their needs in Mississippi. They've done a great job at that, at least it's from my viewpoint so far.
Yeah, no, there's no doubt. But, you know, Ole Miss just doesn't recruit Mississippi any longer. I mean, they are effectively recruiting from coast to coast. And, you know, this is a national brand when it comes to college football. And, you know, expect them to continue to recruit coast to coast.
There was an article written by Tyler Comas. I thought it was is really interesting because I think the Georgia game last year, David, just kind of, if anything, it kind of set up the 24 season for Ole Miss. We were in the locker room or the press availability at the end of the game, Georgia last year, and Lane Kiffin came in, and he wasn't defeated. If anything, he was challenged, and he basically said that we don't have the players to compete with Georgia. And someone obviously asked the question, what needs to happen for you to get to where Georgia is and what needs to happen for you to win? He says, we just don't have the players to win these games. We didn't make the calls we needed to as a staff. We didn't make the plays we needed to as personnel. And I think that catapulted Ole Miss into this year's 24-year season by how well they recruited the portal. The story in and of itself talks about how Ole Miss is preparing for that 24 season upcoming and how the Georgia game changed that. But I thought it was interesting, too, as Tyler pointed out, right now Georgia, a 9.5-point favorite in Oxford. Obviously, we're a lot of water traveling under the bridge until we get there, but pretty fair early line for Georgia right now, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you got to look at last year's game, which you have. I think the line is 5.5. Is that right? Georgia by 5.5.
Yes, yes.
I think that's pretty good. And, you know, the game's in Oxford. I fully would be disappointed if Ole Miss doesn't go into that game unbeaten, to be quite honest with you. And yeah, I know you're talking, well, you got to beat LSU and Baton Rouge. You got to beat Oklahoma and Oxford. Look, the Ole Miss roster is really personnel rich. Okay. And I like this roster, our roster, better than I like LSU's and better than I like Oklahoma's. And I like our coaching staff better than those two aforementioned schools. I know it's the SEC, and generally anybody can beat anybody on any given Saturday. But, you know, Brad, I'll be 53 in July. And, you know, I've given this a lot of thought. In my 53 years on planet Earth, this is the one Ole Miss team that has legitimate national championship promise. I was born in 1971, so I missed the Johnny Vaught glory years. But this team has it all. And with an expanded playoff, should certainly be in the 12-team field. And should, you know, and look, I've got something coming up with Keith Carter about how, you know, hypothetically, how playoff tickets would be distributed and whatnot. That'll be coming up either today or Friday on Inside the Rebels. But this team has it all. And I mean, you pinch yourself, but, you know, the portal did really no damage to Ole Miss. Yet we're bringing in the number one portal class in America. And as Lane preached last year, you got to meld all that talent together. But on paper, tell me a weakness this team has. I'm asking you, can you tell me one weakness? Used to, we could go back and we could tell you four or five position groups where the depth is thin or there's not much talent there. Name me one area of concern.
Offensively, there's not one, with the exception of, you lost Quinshon Judkins and Kedrick Riscano. Normally you would pass out if you get those losses, but with you get Henry Parrish Jr. back, now all of a sudden you pair him up with the running backs .
Don't forget about Ja'Cory Kroski Merritt.
Right.
This kid from New Mexico, who wiggles. I love his film. So you got Kroski Merritt, you got Parrish, you got Ulysses Bentley.
Right.
And I mean.
So to answer your question, that's definitely not going to be a detriment.
The holes are going to be there for those guys, because really and truly, and you were worried about losing offensive linemen over the portal period. We didn't lose a single one.
That surprises me.
You've got talent enough that honestly, you could have two starting five on the offensive line. And it was surprising.
I don't know that Ole Miss has ever had that type of depth at the offensive front, David.
Well, you got two future NFL guys at tight end, Caden Priestcorn and Daquan Wright. And wide receivers, Trey Harris, Jordan Watkins, that whole crew, all of the production back there. And look, the best is yet to come, I think. Deion Smith doesn't get here until the end of this month. And Deion Smith, I think, will be the most talented wide receiver on this roster. With all due respect to Trey Harris and Jordan Watkins, anybody that saw Deion Smith play last fall, you were like, man, this kid does not need to be playing junior college football from a talent standpoint. There is nobody on the field that can cover this kid, period.
No doubt. Best receiving core in the history, or at least as long as I've been alive.
Literally from top to bottom, I think there are seven or eight guys on the Ole Miss roster in the wide receivers room that one day will be cashing checks from NFL football teams.
Incredible amount of talent there. Answer your question, David, and this, you may be able to quell those issues, but I think maybe a little bit more depth in the back half of the secondary, because the defensive line's loaded, linebacking core is in really good shape. Maybe a couple of DBs. Other than that, I just don't know that there's any issues with the offense or defense so far.
Yeah, I really don't think the secondary will be an issue. Ole Miss brought in Brian Brown, who as co-defensive coordinator, but he's also coaching cornerbacks. I think Wes Neighbors is one of the best safeties coach in America. He's also a hell of a recruiter. And I'm extremely confident that Pete Golding is very close to having the same caliber of tools in his box at Ole Miss that he played with at Alabama. And, here we go. We're talking about a Delta State earlier. Pete Golding from Delta State played football at Delta State. So I really don't see a weakness, Brad.
Here we are, May the 2nd, and we're already talking about this season. That's how big this season is going to be. Already kind of breaking down the schedule, and we'll do that throughout the summer, because it'll be here before you know it. And that Georgia game last year, as Tyler points out in the story, just a kind of a catapulting point towards the next season. And Lane did exactly as he said he was going to do in that press conference. He went to, went back to the drawing board, figured out ways to address the inefficiencies as a team. And boy, he did that.
Walker Jones told me, he said after the Georgia game, he was like, you know, we sat up there watching that beating and taking notes. We need this and we need that. We don't have one of these. They went out and fixed it. On paper, they fixed it. Now, you got to play all the games.
Yeah. Got to play.
But on paper, they fixed it. And I'm telling you guys, this is it. I mean, they went all in. They went whole hog in the transfer portal. They knew they had a great nucleus coming back, and they went out and made that nucleus greater with the players they're adding. How about this? And I think Tyler's got a story coming up on this at some point on Thursday. But Jackson Dart now has the fourth best odds of winning the Heisman Trophy this year.
And that's only going to get better the first couple of weeks of the season. Those odds are going to shoot up the board. And, Dave, we only have about a minute to go. But that's huge news. By the way, that story is on the site right now. Good job by Tyler. Just go to Rebs247.com. That's an affiliate of 24/7 Sports. That's, of course, Inside the Rebels. That's where you'll find David Johnson, along with Jared Redding and all the transfer news, transfer portal news on the Ole Miss men's basketball team. David, of course, takes care of women's basketball. Coach Joe's got a great team coming as well. All of this podcast couldn't happen without our good friends at the College Corner Store, located right off of Sisk Avenue. They're in Northeast Oxford. Go by and see them today. They had a huge sale. New inventory's coming in, and they're gearing up for this 24 run. You can gear up with them as well. Little Mill, you heard about it on the Red and Blue Crew podcast. David, I appreciate everything. It's been a wild week, and it's only going to continue to get even more fun. For David Johnson, I'm Brad Logan. We'll talk to you soon. Talk to you again right here on the Red and Blue Crew podcast.
Howdy, Toddy.
College Corner is headed to Oxford. Stop by their new location in the Oxford Commons off Sisk Avenue. They'll have 4,000 square feet of Rebel gear ready for your trip to the Grove. On your next trip to Oxford, stop by the College Corner or our other great locations in Ridgeland and Flowood. Hats, shirts, polos, pullovers, sweats, t-shirts. College Corner has it all. And as always, you can visit us online at collegecornerstore.com. That's collegecornerstore.com. The College Corner, where your game day apparel meets.
It is a place which exerts an extraordinary pull on all who have walked its hallowed ground. Thousands come each year, and yet no one ever really leaves. Ole Miss is for life, a major university with the familiar intimacy of family. Friendships that are more than friendships, moments that are more than moments. An autumn celebration on a Saturday afternoon in the Grove. Contests waged and triumphs savored. With our largest freshman class, soaring honors college, national reputation for academics and research, our pride is overflowing. Today, more than ever, for all who have ever called this magical place home, you never leave Ole Miss.
You've been listening to the Red and Blue Crew podcast with your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. From the Inside the Rebels studios, join us next time right here on the Red and Blue Crew podcast.